Good morning, my name is Dave Morrow, and it's my privilege to serve as your presiding elder this morning. So if you would turn to the front of your bulletin, please, and join me responsibly in the welcome and identity segment. We are disciples of Christ, a movement for wholeness and a fragmented world.
United in spirit, inspired by God's grace, we welcome all, love all, and seek justice for all.
May the peace of God be with you.
And also with you.
Tell you what, let's start things out this morning with a happy announcement, which some of you might not be aware of because it happened kind of late last night. Maybe you weren't aware of the fact that the Chardon baseball team won the state championship. So our congratulations need to go to the players, the coaches, and the entire student body of Chardon school system. So it's quite an honor. I mean, I don't remember the last time it was that a high school won two state championships in one school year, but I don't think it's happened very often in the past. Way to go, Hilltoppers. Other announcements. The face masks, if you want one, are back in the narthex. The offering plate is at the entrance to the sanctuary, the entrance to the church. Please sign the attendance roster in your bulletin and pass it on down the aisle so we know you're here today. There's a picnic after church today, and everybody's invited. And I think Steve has done a good job of maybe arranging the weather for us. It looks like it's going to be maybe decent. So,
well, yeah.
Just give a little optimistic with those things. And then take a look at your bulletins for the rest of the activities they have scheduled for this summer, which are considerable. Continuing on the bulletin, please join me in the call to worship. Ascribe to our God in glory, all glory and honor.
Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. All earth is the Lord of glory.
Come and worship in his holy splendor. Please turn to hymn number 75 in your hymnal. I was in there to hear your warning. Wow.
Thank you.
to make us whole. As we gather in worship, may we praise you with our hearts and reveal you in our lives. We pray that you will bless our youth and children this day, especially those who commit their lives to you. And bless all of us, that we may respond to their commitment with unconditional love. This we pray in the holy name of God, three in one. Amen. Join me in repeating the Lord's Prayer. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Gather here on this side so you can see this. That's good. So gather on this side. I think everybody in the church by now is aware we are both United Church of Christ and Disciples. This is the Disciples' side where we immerse. Over there, there's a font where we sprinkle, and we'll use them both. Evan, before I baptize you, I'd like to ask you, do you believe that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself? Do you accept God's forgiveness of all your wrongdoings, and do you promise to share God's forgiveness with others?
I do.
Thank you. Evan Michael, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. The whole church say, Amen.
Amen.
You may, if you'd like, applaud.
Thank you.
Please be seated. Brothers and sisters in Christ, today is the day of the Great Commission, Sunday for baptisms, and we are going to have several today. Standing before you now are Oliver and his parents, and Oliver is going to be baptized. Oliver is Maisie and Rob's grandson. So, to you, his parents, do you believe that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself? And do you accept the forgiveness offered by God in Christ? And do you promise to share that forgiving love with those you encounter? So please say we do.
We do.
Do you promise to raise this child in the faith? If so, please so we say we do. And what name is given this child?
Oliver Craig.
Oliver Craig. Can I hold on? Hello, Oliver. Oliver, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Let the church say amen.
Amen.
Can I hold your hand over? This does take a while. I want you to come over here, Oliver. I present to you your new little brother in Christ, Oliver Craig Walters. Forgiving love, and you promise to share that love with those you encounter in the world. So please say we do. Holy Spirit. Let us all say
amen.
Would the rest of our faith formation class come forward? Heather, do you want them in the middle? Please. So those who have not been baptized have already been baptized as children. I'm going to ask you all to face me, please. So for those of you who have already been baptized, I will ask you the same question. Do you believe God was in Christ, reconciling the world to himself? Do you accept God's forgiving love? And do you promise to share that love with those you encounter in the world? If so, please say, I do. Back up a little. Remember your baptism. Be thankful. Back up. Remember your baptism. Be thankful. Remember your baptism. Be thankful. Remember your baptism. Be thankful. Logan, remember your baptism. Be thankful. Nathan, remember your baptism. Remember your baptism. Be thankful. See. Remember your baptism. Be thankful.
Jesus Christ calls us to make disciples of all nations and to offer them the gift of grace in baptism. Do you who witness and celebrate this sacrament promise your love, support, and care to the ones about to be baptized as they live and grow in Christ?
Promise your love, support, and care.
Seated in front of you, they are your family. If you ever need anything, I trust that all of you out there would support them in not just necessarily in what they want, but more importantly, in what they need. I feel like any one of you out there, they could go to if they need something, and you would support them and do what they need you to do. And so those are your mothers and fathers and grandmothers and grandfathers in the faith, as well as your brothers and sisters in the faith. And these brothers and sisters are your new brothers and sisters in church. Thank you all.
This morning is found in the Gospel Matthew. If you want to follow along while I read this on page 32 in your Pew Bible, actually the last several verses of the chapter. Now the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. Remember, I am with you always to the end of the age." This is the Word of God, the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. And so, every year, the first Sunday after Pentecost is a holiday. And we call this holiday the Feast of the Holy Trinity. It's always been my custom, no matter what, to use Holy, Holy, Holy as the first hymn on this day, except obviously today, because this is going to be a longer service, and there were other hymns I wanted to sing. I was prepared to do four hymns, but cut that one out. I'm sorry. Maybe next week we'll sing Holy, Holy. This, of course, is the day that I am supposed to explain God to you all, the Christian God. That is God in three persons, Blessed Trinity. And I think I actually did try that once in a church, not one of my better sermons. So today, I want to go in a slightly different direction. I want to compare two concepts that are important to all of us here, and those two concepts are God and church. You see, the clearest we can actually be about God is to say that God is beyond our ability to understand God. God is a mystery. So we're tempted to think of God as unknowable, a distant, uncaring being, uninvolved with creation. But the Bible tells us a different story. God is a God who cares. And there are different ways that we can relate to God. There's the God who created the beauty that surrounds us out there in nature, even above us in the universe. There's the God who came to us in the flesh, who lived our life, and who died our death, so that we might never again, not ever again in all of eternity, be separated from God. And there's the God that lives within us as we struggle with life. The same one who connects us to each other and strengthens us to serve our neighbor. So it's safe to say that God is not a God in isolation. The very nature of God is God in relationship, God in community. And so it's only appropriate that it's in community that we worship God and learn about God and share our own insights about God. Imagine, if you will, person
whose ideas about God are so set in stone that they are unable to share their experience and unwilling to listen to others who want to share their own experience. This is a person, I don't think, who's ever going to be able to grow in faith, and whose faith will probably never make a positive difference in the world. Just as our God is found in different ways and different experiences, so we gather with others to share how God has come to each one of us, so that we can learn and grow in the faith. Because God is Trinity, Christians are community. We believe in the Trinity, but that's a word that's never actually used in the Bible. I know that's probably hard for some of you to believe, but you'll never see the word Trinity in the Bible, despite the fact that we say we believe in it. And the Trinity is only specifically mentioned as the three persons of the Trinity in a single verse of the Bible. And we heard that verse today. It's the one contained in this morning's scripture reading that says, "Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit." This verse actually has a name. It's called the Great Commission. At its most basic, it means that Christians have a responsibility, the responsibility to share our faith. Now, for people like me, that means baptizing those believers and their households. I'm also responsible, however, for living out my faith. You probably wouldn't think that much of me at all if I did my job here in the church and then didn't live like a Christian out in the world. Because others should see my faith in my life. But we ministers of the gospel aren't the only ones. All of us who claim to be Christians must also live out our faith and share what we believe. So church is not just a place where we come to hear about possibilities and theories and then talk amongst ourselves. It's not even a place where we come to hear a sermon and then sit and pray, though that might well be part of what we do. Church is where we have our own stories affirmed and where we find the courage to share those stories, not just here where we might think of it as a safe space, but out in the world where nowadays there are more doubters than believers, it seems. And that's how each of us plays our part in carrying out the Great Commission. I look out there and I see a lot of people I know. And I see that some of us talk. Some of us march. Some of us cook. Some of us sing. Some of us fold. Some of us host. Some of us build. Some of us clean. Some of us teach. And some of us visit. Those are just a few of the ways that you all carry out the Great Commission in your lives. You name it, if it helps somebody, it's a way of sharing the love of God. And it's taking part in the Great Commission. And I want to close there today, not just because we need to end the service sometime, but because I think that's saying enough. Whatever gifts God has given you that you can share with the world, you can use that gift to share the love of Christ, the love of God. Now, I've got a few prayer requests here I'd like to share with you. We want to pray that Gail's daughter will give her a call. Prayers for Leon Perkins, that's Rick's brother, who is in ICU with COVID. We want to pray for a son losing a fight with addiction. And finally, I want to say a special prayer for Roz as she retraces a painful part of our history May our church express love for all people as we support the Pride Festival that's going on in Chardon Square next weekend. And we also want to recognize Roz. I'd like for Roz to stand up right now. Roz is going on a pilgrimage to retrace the steps of the civil rights movement. And when are you leaving, Roz?
Pardon?
When are you leaving?
Tuesday.
Roz is leaving Tuesday to go to Alabama, and she'll be in Selma on the Edmund Pettus Bridge. She's going to the Civil Rights Museum, and I think, are you going to Birmingham?
Pardon me?
Are you going to Birmingham?
Birmingham and Montgomery.
And Montgomery. So she'll go to visit the church that was blown up during the civil rights struggle. So I just want, especially the kids today, to know Roz is sort of an example that joining the church is not the end. We continue to witness to our faith in all kinds of different ways as we grow older. And Roz is a example not of growing older, but so let me say, or leave a little room at the beginning of the prayer for your silent prayers, and then I'll gather our prayers together. Let's pray. Eternal God, you have made us, and you know us better than we could possibly know ourselves. Accept what is right in us, and the good that is done through us. But whatever is wrong or spiteful about us, we ask you to overcome it with your love. Lord Jesus Christ, you have shown us the way to the Father's house. Help us to stay by your side that we might make it to the end of our journey. And O God, the Holy Spirit, open our hearts and minds to Christ's truth, that we might live God's love. O God, three in one, gather the scattered, calm the fearful, comfort the sorrowful, and encourage the indifferent. Renew the very language we speak so that it will be fit to proclaim your praise. Today we call down your blessings upon the children and youth of our congregation. We pray especially for those who are baptized this morning and those who profess their faith in you. May they live and grow as part of our faith family, and may they see in us patterns of true discipleship. We also pray your blessings upon our sister Roz, who embarks this week on a journey to learn more about the struggle for civil rights. Bless her hearing, that she may receive all the words that are spoken, and bless her heart and mind, that she may be able to learn and act out on what is taught. Bless the rest of us, O Triune God, that we too might share your teachings with our neighbors, and may the deeds we do and the words we speak never give anyone reason to turn their backs on your church. We pray it in the name of Jesus Christ, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns God forevermore. Amen. Our communion hymn is number 400. I think this might be my favorite hymn in our hymnal. Number 400, let's remain seated as we sing, "When You Do This, Remember Me."
Thank you.
of them. Mortals, you care for them, yet you have made them a little lower than God, crowned them with glory and honor, and have given them the dominion over the works of your hands. Let us therefore offer ourselves and our gifts in return for all of God's blessings. As the deacons come forward, we will rise in body and spirit. Sing the doxology.
Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, he shared it with his disciples. And he said, "Take and eat this, for this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Say something before we gave the benediction.
Just wanted the faith formation partners to come up here. Teenagers together, we're very busy, so hard to meet. you know, but we did what we could, and these seven plus Mariah stood up for them, and very appreciative of their time. It doesn't end today, as all of you, our church family, support these kids in their faith journey. So I just wanted to recognize them and give them a round of applause.
Please don't forget, after the benediction, to go to our church picnic, which we have enough food for everyone, so please stay. Go forth in the peace of God that surpasses our understanding, and may those you meet in the week to come find in you a peaceful presence. Go forth in the love of Christ that knew the meaning of sacrifice, and may those to whom love is a stranger find in you generous friends. Go forth in the power of God's Spirit, filled with the courage to speak and act for the sake of what you believe. Go forth in God, Creator, Christ, and Holy Spirit. Amen.